Okay. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers and especially Alex Kruger for inviting me for this very nice workshop. My talk is a joint work with my colleague Nikolai Osmolovsky, and is devoted to Lagrange multipliers rule for Red General extremum problem with an infinite number of constraints. The talk is will be very simple, and probably many of listeners participants know it this subject very well, but we propose a kind of general and rather simple point of view on this issue. Let us start to the essence. Let x, y, and z several finite numbers of zi will be Banach spaces. In the spaces zi, there are closed convex cones with non-empty interiors. And we consider the following optimization problem. We have to minimize some function of x with respect to these constraints are treated as inequality constraints. And this is equality constraint. F0 and Fi and G are the some corresponding mappings. So this is very general problem, which covers maybe 90% of all problems in applications. Notice that each inequality can be infinite dimensional. If the for example, if the cone Ki is finite faced, then it is a finite number of linear inequalities. But in general, this cone can be given by infinite, only by infinite number of inequalities. So this is a constraint which is not standard for mathematical programming. All the mappings, no, may assume that all the mappings will be smooth in the sense that they are differentiable with respect, in the sense of Fréchet at the reference point x0. And the operator G is also is differentiable in the Fréchet sense in the neighborhood of the point x0, and its derivative is continuous at x0. These are assumptions which can be in a sense weakened, but we will not consider now the more general case. As to equality constraint, we have to assume some kind of regularity assumption. In our case, we assume the weakened regularity assumption, which is that the image of the derivative of this mapping is closed, have closed image. The image is closed in the image space. The best case when this image is the whole space of Y is called regular case. And this is the very well known Lusternik condition. Let us say some words about the statement of the problem. The inequality constraints in the problem can be considered separately each of these constraints can be considered separately, and they they common presence is taken into will be taken into account in the Euler-Lagrange equation. But the moreover, the smoothness assumptions on the inequality constraints can be significantly weakened. We did not consider it here, but we do not need to assume that they are Fréchet differentiable. They can be even convex-like differentiable. I don't give here exact definition. But equality constraints, they have to be considered jointly. We cannot consider them separately if even they can be given by, say, two or three operators. Anyway, they have to be considered jointly as a whole operator, because the regularity assumptions cannot be split into separate parts. And the smoothness assumption on equality constraints are rather high. We can just weaken this assumption about differentiability at most to strict differentiability at x0, not more. But for now, we take these assumptions on of smoothness and regularity. A couple of words about history. Some variants and the particular cases of this problem have been considered by many authors starting from the end of 40s. These are some names of researchers that consider this problem, some versions of this problem. But to our knowledge, the exact statement of the above statement of this problem probably was not considered. But we don't strictly claim this, but anyway, this problem, this statement deserves attention. It is rather general, reasonably general, and covers a very wide class of optimization problems. And we are not pretend to absolute novelty in this talk. Our aim is to give a necessary optimality condition, which is simply formulated, generalizes the classical condition, Euler-Lagrange condition, and very easily and transparently proved and convenient for different applications. So this is why in view of this advantage of the, of this approach, we present it to the optimization society. indicate a typical application of this problem. These are optimal control problems with state constraints of this kind and mixed constraints of this kind. This constraint can be regarded as belonging to the cones of non-positive functions in the spaces C and L infinity. This function belongs to the space of continuous functions to a non-positive cone. And here is L infinity function, which also belongs to the non-positive cone in the space L infinity. Though we assume that all functions, data functions are smooth, our problem is not a usual smooth problem Because any constraint, as I already said, can be given by infinite number of scalar inequality constraints. So this problem can be called semi-smooth, or sometimes it's called semi-infinite problem. Now let us pass to the result. It is as follows. First, we define the polar cone to the cone KIs. This is a standard definition. Now, this is the Lagrange multipliers rule related to this, the above statement. Let X0 be a local minimum point in our problem. Then there exists Lagrange multipliers. Alpha zero, this is multiplier at this cost. Z I star elements of the spaces Z I dual spaces to Z. And Y star element of the dual space to Y. Not all of which are zero. So this collection is non-trivial. And such that Zi star belongs to the dual cone to Ki, polar cone to Ki, and Zi star pairing with Fi of X zero is zero. So each Zi star is an outer normal to the cone Ki at the point Fi for X zero. This is
complementary slackness conditions.
Sorry?
Complementary slackness conditions.
Yeah, yeah. Here. Yes, yes. This is this equality is complementary slackness, yes. So if this is standard construction. So if we have element of the cone and these are outer normal of the to the cone at this point. And if we construct the Lagrange function of our problem, so we multiply the cost and all the constraints of the problem by the corresponding multipliers and take a sum of all these objects. This is standard Lagrange function. This function should be stationary at X zero as a reference point. That is, its derivative is zero. This is all the formulation. If Zi is just a real line and Ki is a negative part, negative semi-line, then it's a polar cone is a positive semi-line, and we obtain, so the multipliers that I star is just a scalar, non-negative scalars, and we apply standard well-known results with scalar multipliers. But in general, Ki can be arbitrary, Ki can be arbitrary cones, solid cones, closed solid convex cones. The conditions, as Nikolai already said, plays the role of complementary slackness conditions. If an index I is inactive, that is Fi of X zero is an interior point of cone Ki, and Z I zero belongs to polar cone of Ki, that any outer normal Zi is zero. Otherwise, it's an obvious property. For example, in problems with state and mixed constraints, the multipliers in this case have the form of Lebesgue-Stieltjes measures, d mu I of t, non-negative measures, each generated by some non-decreasing function m mu I of t. Here it is the element of the space C, and the C star is the space of function of bounded variations. So taking into account that the multiplier should be non-negative, this function of bounded variation is non-decreasing. And here's the measure will be non-negative. And in this case, we have element of L infinity. So each that I star is a functional, is an element from L infinity star, which in some regular case, only in some regular case, is given by some integrable function lambda I of t, by non-negative function lambda I of t. But I would stress that it is only in some regular case. I did not go into detail in this for now, but in general, we have to consider element of L infinity star, which, as it is, as is well known, are very difficult space. But in the regular case, there are no problems. It is just a function from L1 space. And thus, Lagrange function includes the corresponding terms like this in this case, and in the, this case, like this. This is what concerns to applications. Now, let us give a full proof of this result, which is, as I already said, very simple. This proof is based on well-known facts of functional analysis. First, Dubovitsky-Milutin theorem on the non-intersection of convex cones. This is a kind of multi-separation theorem. The Farkas-Minkowski theorem on the dual to the preimage of convex cone. A lemma on the annihilator to the kernel of a surjective operator. And the Lusternik theorem on the tangent subspace. Let us recall these facts. Let omega 1 and omega m, these are finite numbers, and h, finite numbers of convex cones in a topological vector space X, among which these first m cones are open. The last cone can be arbitrary, but they all are convex, and non-empty, of course. Then their intersection is empty if and only if there exists functionals pi from omega I star, from the conjugate cone to omega I, q from h star, not all zero, such that their sum is zero. This last relation is called Euler-Lagrange Euler-Lagrange equation. This rather strange, seems to be strange term, strange name, is justified by the fact that the standard Euler-Lagrange equation and the even maximum principle in problems of optimal control can be deduced from this equation if it is applied in a specially prepared situation. Here, omega star is the conjugate con, the standard definition. The proof of this theorem follows from the Hahn-Banach separation theorem, and if in fact these are equivalent statements. We do not give this proof because it is very well known and can be easily proved. The Farkas-Minkowski theorem, also very well known fact. Let X and Y be topological vector spaces and A be a linear continuous operator. Recall that its adjoint operator A star maps Y star to X star such that any Y star small is mapped to a functional X star defined by the relation X star X. The pairing of X star X is equal to Y star paired by with AX. So X star is Y star, A star Y star. Or in physical notation, which is sometimes more convenient for dealing with, it is X star. If we delete X, we have, obtain X star is Y star A. It is very convenient to make some calculations. Now, the theorem, Farkas-Minkowski theorem, asserts that if K the space Y be a convex cone with an empty interior and its preimage under this mapping be non-empty, then X star belongs is a element of conjugate cone if and only if there exists Y star from the conjugate cone to K such that X star is Y star A star Y star. That is omega star equal to A star K star. Or in physical notation, we can write it like this. This is a very well-known fact. Now the next fact, let now X and Y be Banach spaces and A still be a linear operator. if the operator A is surjective, then the annihilator to the kernel of this operator is equal to the image of the conjugate operator. This means that this relation means that X star X is equal to Y, like this is relation like on the previous slide. In other words, any linear functional X star vanishing on the kernel of this operator has the form Y star AX with some Y is Y star capital. The reverse assertion is trivial. For example, if Y is just a finite dimensional space, we have that condition. What it means that X star vanish on ker A means that if AX is zero, these are finite number of scalar relations where all AA are linear functionals on X. This relation should imply that X star na X is also zero. But from the linear algebra, it is known that then X is a linear combination of these functionals. This exactly means that for some Y star, which is now a finite dimensional vector, we have this relation. To work with equality constraints, we need Lusternik theorem on the tangent subspace. Let a nonlinear operator G maps X to Y. Zx0 is y0, and let M be the level set that z of x is y0. Suppose that the derivative of g maps onto. This is Lusternic condition. Then x bar is tangent to this level set M at the point x0 is equivalent to the fact that x bar is belongs to the kernel of the derivative. That is this relation. No, this theorem is a simple corollary of more strong one, but I skip it. Now, proof of Lagrange multipliers rule. Our proof follows the so-called Dubovitsky-Milutin scheme, which was proposed in the mid of 60s. It consists of two steps, just of two steps. As the first step, we pass from the local minimality at our point, reference point, to the incompatibility of some conic or even linear, in some cases, some conic or linear approximations of all the constraints and the cost of the problem. We approximate all the constraints and the cost of the problem. And if at the point, reference point, we have local minimality, these approximations do not intersect. And then the second step, this incompatibility of approximation, we rewrite it as the corresponding Euler-Lagrange equation. Now we will do this program. For any I, for any index I, define the cone of interior directions to the cone Ki at the point Zi, which is Fi of x0. This is, so these are such directions Z bar, such that there are alpha positive, strictly positive, such that if we move in the direction of Z bar for some distance, we get to interior of the cone Ki. Obviously, Ci is interior Ki, interior Ki minus the ray generated by this element. Or since sum of this element also belongs to Ki, this is just sum of Ki plus this line, this full line RFi of x0. It is non-empty, convex, and open. And its conjugate cone is a part of conjugate cone of Ki with this condition. If the index I is inactive, that is, if Fi of x0 is interior point in Ki, then obviously Ci is the whole space Zi, and Ci star is just zero. That lemma of on non-intersection of approximation. If we have a regular case and x0 is a local minimum, then there is no direction x bar satisfying this system. There is no direction x bar in which we strictly in which we minimize the functional in the first order. If in which we go in first order, go to the interior of our cone Ki, that is it, this expression belongs to Ci. And if we are tangent to the level set of equality operator. Proof. Suppose that such X bar exists. Since the X bar belongs to the kernel of J star prime, by the Lusternic theorem, it is tangent to this surface. That is, there exists a correction R epsilon, which is small O small of epsilon, such that the point, point X epsilon, which is X zero plus epsilon X bar, plus this correction lies on the surface. That is, satisfies the equality constraint. So this curve satisfies the equality constraint. Now consider the inequality constraints. For any I, we have fi of x0 is in ki, and the fi plus alpha, fi prime x bar, belongs to interior of ki. This is definition of the con ci for some alpha, positive alpha. Then the whole half interval lies in interior of ki. This is interior consists of interior points of ki. Then fi of our curve using the expansion, simple expansion up to the first order term, this is fi of this point plus fi multiplied by this increment epsilon x bar plus or small of epsilon. Since this is in ki, this interior ki, this also will be in interior ki for small epsilon. Similarly, the cost functional also will satisfy this inequality, strong inequality, strict inequality for small enough epsilon, positive epsilon. Thus, we have that the point, this our curve, satisfies all the constraints, but violates the local minimality at this point, at the x0. A contradiction. So indeed, such x bar cannot exist. Now we only have to pass to the Euler-Lagrange equation. Let x0 be a local minimum. We consider the regular case when equality operator is regular. The derivative of the cost is non-zero. And the image of the derivative of the inequalities intersects with the ki. This is here ki. So the cons ci are non-empty. Then all the cons in our system is non-empty, and by lemma two, they do not intersect. Now, by using Dubovitsky-Milutin multi-separation theorem, we assert that there exists a support functional x zero star to the half space, this half space, support functional x y star to the cons, these cons, and annihilator to the X star to the subspace, to the kernel of equality, to the derivative of equality operators, not all of which are zero, such that their sum is zero. Now, we can use the presentation of our elements, these support functionals for our specific case. X zero star is just minus alpha zero F prime zero of X naught with some alpha zero non-negative. By the Farkas-Minkowski theorem, X Y star is just Z Y star F I prime of X zero with some ZY star from C star, CI star. And by a lemma on the annihilator, X star is just Y star by J star of J prime of X zero with some Y star capital. So what we obtain, we get this equation. Now recall that minus z prime star is belong to the polar contour k, because the z y star belongs to the k star, so minus z y star belongs to k y polar cone with this relation. And if we, so we can here put here minus, and if we change here y star to minus y star, which is admissible, we obtain the Euler-Lagrange equation. The degenerate case are trivial. This obtain the that our equation fulfills in a trivial form. So theorem is completely proven.
Hi, Andre. I would just remind that this is the last talk, but our colleague from Victoria State probably would want to go to sleep.
I will finish. Soon I will finish. Just, in fact, we are finished, but I just indicate some generalization. Generalization concerns that the cones Ki can be given by sublinear inequalities. I skip the details. Instead of the cones Ki, we can consider arbitrary closed convex sets, Qi, with non-empty interiors. That is, problem can be the, of the form, the F0 to minimize, Fi of X belongs to Qi, this convex closed cones, and still G of X is zero. In this case, the Lagrange function still has the form where Zy star is outer normals to Qi at the point Fi of X0. And the proof of necessary condition, L prime of X0 is zero, remains the same. I've skipped this. Okay. As a particular case, we can consider standard problem of convex programming. And then the Euler-Lagrange equation is nothing else but the subdifferential form of the Karun-Shkun-Tucker theorem. In this purely convex case, the Lagrange function is, in fact, a support function to the usual function of problem 7. If we problem 7, consider the standard function of Lagrange function, then L tilde, then this equation is just means that L tilde, differential of L tilde contains zero. That is, this convex function attains its minimum over all space X at the point X zero. So we get standard optimality condition in convex programming. And now some references in which we consider this problem. And thank you for attention.
Thank you, Andre, for your talk. So now it's time for questions.
May I ask one?
Okay.
So first of all, thank you very much, Andre, for reminding the audience about Dubovitsky-Milutin scheme, which is a very beautiful result and a powerful tool. It was extremely popular some time ago. Now, not many people remember, unfortunately, about it, although it could still be used to solve problems. My question is about your inequality type constraints. So you are working with a finite number of inequality type constraints defined by either cones with non-empty interior or arbitrary sets in your most recent slides with also non-empty interior. I'm just wondering if this finite number of constraints can be replaced by a single one. If
yes, we consider the product of the image spaces and the joint operator of inequality constraints, and we have one constraint in a inequality constraint in a product space. Yes, we have.
Then why do you need finite number of
constraints? Just for relation with the standard problem, mm-hmm. just for, in this, for this reason.
Okay,
yes, you are right, you are right. We can consider one inequality constraint, yes.
I'm not sure we can understand you easily, Hong Kong.
Oh, yes. Yes, can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can even hear you before when you were speaking Chinese.
Yeah, yes, I'm talking to my wife. I'm at home now. That's right. Good morning. Good morning. You cannot hear me. I don't want to test if you can hear me now. Good.
So, thank you. Thank you, Andrei, for your talk and for answering my question. Back to you, Hua.
So is there any other questions from the audience? Now we have unlimited time for the questions.
I have a question.
Yeah.
I have a question, excuse me. But, well.
Okay, Eva, okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good morning, and I also would like to thank you to both authors because I know that Nikolai Osmołowski is also with us. So I appreciate very much your results and your talk. And my question is because, as far as I understood, it is very crucial in your presentation that the interiors of. If I am right, my question is do you see some possibilities to include in your research the case when at least some of the cones KI have empty interior? Thank you.
Yeah, okay, thank you, Eva, for your question. I think that we cannot admit empty interiors in inequality constraints. In this case, we have to consider either to reduce the image space in order that the constraints will have in non-empty interiors, if it is possible. Or we have to consider them as equality constraints. This is a general position in the Dubovitsky-Milutin scheme that inequality constraints should have non-empty interiors. If this some constraint have empty interior, we have related to equality constraints and consider jointly with all equality constraints.
Okay. Thank you very much. And also maybe another question. Do you see or do you consider also out of this presentation, but conditions which guarantee that alpha zero is strictly greater than zero in your Lagrangian?
The only condition here is that which is natural and very well known that that equality constraint should be regular and there should exist direction which is from the kernel of operator to from the kernel of the derivative of equality constraints and lies in the interior of linearized inequality constraint. In fact, this is a kind of Mangasarian Framovitz condition like this.
Yeah. Or, okay.
Linearized Mangasarian Framovitz condition. Call it such, in such way.
I see. Okay. Thank you once again for the very interesting talk. Thank you to both authors and to your
thank
answers.
Thank you for attention. Thank you for oral presentation.
So is there any more questions?
Николай Кутшевап, actually. Yes, thank you, Николай.
I'm here, I'm here.
I have one more question,
nice to see you. Possible. Nice to see
yes.
You.
Okay.
Can I
speak? So we have one more question, yeah.
Thank you, yeah. Nikolai. Good to see you.
Good to see you as well.
I think we have one more question from the audience.
Yeah, I would like to make one more question to both the author, if possible. Could you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Spasiba. Thank you very much for your presentation. It was very interesting to me. I remember your special terminology from the Moscow School in some related to some result, like the what you mentioned, the annihilator lemma and so on. And my question is related to some perspective in the case of non-regularity, because your result is based essentially on regularity assumptions.
Of course.
Concerning yes. The equality constraints, I mean, okay?
Yes, yes.
And do you have some idea, some extension in the case of the derivative operator is not subject, is not on two, is not subjective. So you don't you cannot apply the Eusternik theorem directly.
Yes, yes. If we directly apply, we obtain trivial result. Yes, sure, sure. But to my opinion, this we did not consider this case, and this case is investigated by some researchers like
Tretyakov
and others.
Yeah.
Avakov. Tretyakov, of course.
Maybe Nikolai can say more.
Yes, Tretyakov also investigated this case, and Avakov, Rutsunov, you are right.
Okay, but I saw. Thank you very much, anyhow.
You're welcome.
Anyway, this case, this degenerate case is much more difficult,
of course.
Technically very cumbersome.
Okay, thank you very much, the speaker, for your talk.